Hello students,
I am back for one more video of applied English, and it is based on listening. In the previous video students, I have given an assessment task, and based on that assessment task, we are going to have a doubt solving video on part 2. We had a lot of discussion on part 2, but this is part 2 and there are total 11 to 20 questions, and we are going to discuss what answer should be. Students, this is Saraswati Sisukunj Baghwala Bursar and it is Applied English. And students, this is video number 22. I have written there are total 3 questions, but it should be 11 to 15. Rest of the questions I will write later on. Students, now we are going to discuss what answer should be. This is all MCQ type, students, and then fill in the blanks as well. Students, I have written total 3 questions, 11, 12 and 13. I am going to play a listening track for you, that is part 2. You need to do listening, write your answers in the answer sheet and we will discuss what answer should be. Students, this is all MCQ type. You need to listen to the conversation. So there is a conversation between an administration of IELTS and the second one, a candidate who is going to appear for the IELTS examination. Students, without delay, I am going to play a listening track for you, and the listening track is here. Start listening.
You will hear a conversation between an IELTS candidate and an IELTS administrator.
First, you have some time to look at questions 11 to 15. Now, listen carefully and answer questions 11 to 15.
Good afternoon. I'm applying for a master's program at the University of Exeter in the UK. I'm planning to register for the IELTS exam at your centre next month. I have some questions I'd like to ask you before I register, if that's okay.
Certainly. Would you be taking the academic module?
I think so, but I'll have to contact the university just to make sure.
You'll probably need the academic because most universities don't accept the general training. And anyway, the procedures to register for the exam are the same for both the general and the academic modules.
Good. My first question is whether I sit all parts of the exam on the same day. I don't live here, you see. And for me, it would be more convenient to do all the papers on the same day.
Unfortunately, the speaking part is scheduled for Thursdays, and reading, writing and listening tests take place on Saturdays. We can't change the days, I'm afraid.
That's a pity. Well, never mind. What sort of documents do I need to bring in order to register?
You'll have to fill in the IELTS application form and bring an ID, a copy of your ID, and 2 passport-sized photos on a white background.
Will any ID do?
We only accept original passports and national IDs.
That's good to know. Did you say that reading, writing, and listening are scheduled for Saturday?
That's right.
Will I get a break in between the papers?
I'm afraid there aren't any breaks between the papers. Each paper takes an hour to complete, so it's 3 hours straight through. You'll first do listening and then reading, followed by the writing test. This is a standard requirement from Cambridge.
Before you hear the rest of the talk, you have some time to look at questions 16 to 20. Now listen and answer questions 16 to 20.
Okay, and how soon after the test can I pick up my results?
It takes 13 calendar days for the results to be processed.
Can you let me know how much it is and the form of payment?
The examination fee is $200. You can pay by credit or debit card. We also accept checks. We only accept cash as a form of payment in exceptional circumstances.
And one last question. Can I mail you the application documents?
Certainly. You can send all the documents by registered mail to our address, 47 Clover Place, New Rochelle, New York.
Could you spell New Rochelle for me, please?
Certainly. NEWROCHELLE.
Could I have the zip code as well?
Sure. Our zip code is 10806.
Thanks.
You can also email us at inquiry@examsmail.com or phone us at 325-9082.
I think that's all. Thank you very much for all the information. Bye.
You're welcome. Goodbye.
That is the end of part two.
You now have half a minute to check your answers.
Students, I hope you have written your answers in the answer sheet. Now students, there are total 3 questions I have written, but it is 11 to 15. That means 2 questions that I will write later on. Students, now 11, 12 and 13, and it is an MCQ type of question. Students, now which of the statement is true? In the beginning I said there is a conversation between an IELTS student, that means a candidate, and an IELTS administrator. Now students, we will discuss what answer should be, and the conversation goes on. The IELTS candidate wants some information from the IELTS administrator, and she asks so many questions. Now, I am not sure which course that I would like to take, and I would like to book an IELTS date. She has so many questions, and as you hear, and students, she is planning to take a course in the UK in one of the universities. Now students, which of the statement is true? The candidate wants, okay? There are 3 options given, and you can hear all 3 options, but there is a much more emphasis on option C, that is not sure which module she needs to take. She wants to take an examination date, and she wants any one of the module she needs to take, and she is not sure. So what is the answer? The answer is C. She is not sure which module she needs to take. When the conversation goes on, you can hear on which days would the candidate like to take the exam date. Okay. And she wants to finish it all 3 or 4 modules in one day, that is the same day. Different days or weekends, usually what happens, on the same day that 3 modules, listening, reading and writing has to be done. Now this is the 13th one. The listening, reading and writing test take place on, when does it take place? So it usually takes place on Saturday, that you can clearly hear in the conversation. So all 3 types of questions, this is MCQ type of questions that you get, and all 3 questions that you hear clearly in the conversation. This is part 2. Now I am going to write 2 more questions on the board, that is 14 and 15. Students, now these are the 2 questions that I have written on the board, and then we are going to discuss what answer should be. What kind of ID can the candidate not use? Now students, many times what happens, you know, we always tend to write positive questions or have a positive look. But now it is a negative and hence I have written in an inverted comma. Now students, there are total three options. We have driving license, a library card and a passport. Here I write a library, a driving. A driving license, a library card and a passport. Now, it is a negative. What kind of ID can the candidate not use? Okay, so certainly there is one of the IDs, driving license, passport. So in the conversation, if you have deep listening very attentively, you can hear that, okay, this is driving license. It is a kind of nationality card or the national card you get. Passport also, you can hear the two passport size of photo with white background, passport, and which card? Library card. But it is not spoken, it is not said in the conversation, but library card is not used by the candidate. Okay, so what is the correct answer? The correct answer is a library card. And the conversation goes on. The candidate will not do listening, reading and writing test. The candidate will do the listening, reading and writing test. Well, with 1 hour breaks between the test or with 15 minute breaks between the test. Now students, in the conversation that goes on and you can hear that there is without break, that means listening, reading and writing, there is, you know, one slot that you need to complete and it is without break, you need to finish. So this is without break that you can clearly hear in the conversation. Now students, we have completed 11 to 15 and now remaining 16 to 20 that we will discuss and we will write on the board what answer should be and we will discuss. Students, now we are going to discuss question 16 to 20. Now as you hear the conversation and it is clearly mentioned in it that what the further information. Now, the candidate wants to know after completing the examination, after how many days that she can get a result. Okay, so there is a particular number that 13 you can get. Okay, it is clearly mentioned in the conversation, students. When you do listening very attentively, you get that how sooner the candidate asks how sooner I get my result when I complete the IELTS examination. So, what is the number after 13 days? That number of days get result after 13 days that she will get the result. Okay. And what is the fee that administrator says that you need to fill up the form and along with the form that you need to pay test fee and it is $200. Okay, you can hear very clearly when you do very carefully listen to students. Okay. Now send documents, register mail. She has to send the documents to exam administrator. Students, when you do listening or when you have completed your listening, there is a spelling, a wrong spelling is given, but here this is administrator. Okay, that have a keep in mind. Okay. Now 47 lower place. Here you get question number 18. And what is that? It is clearly mentioned new Russia. So the examiner says or the administrator repeats LEWROCHELLE that you clearly hear in the conversation. Okay. Now the candidate asks me, I know the zip code and the zip code is 10806. It's not 10806 but it's a 010806. Okay. And the last you get the email ID, contact email, that means there is email ID also mentioned. So inquiry at examsmail.com. Okay, and the contact number, it's mentioned in the conversation that 3559082. What is the contact number, students? Contact number is 3259082. that you can hear in the competition. Students, this is part 2. We have a doubt solving video of 11 to 20 and it is part 2. Students, now I am going to give an assessment task for you after this video. And there is also, I have taken part 2 only. It contains total 10 questions of part 2 of Applied English. And you need to write your answers the next day. I will send an answer key that you need to check and let me know. Now I am going to play a listening track for you. And the listening track is here. Start listening.
Part 2.
You will hear a talk on local radio about a short film festival in the town of Adbourne. Now you have some time to look at questions 11 to 16. Now listen and answer questions 11 to 16.
Today we're pleased to have on the show Fatima Johnson, who is the organiser of the Adbourne Film Festival. Welcome, Fatima.
Hello.
Can you tell us a bit about the background to the festival and what it brings to the town?
Well, the festival was started in 1996 by the then mayor of Adbourne, Joanne Smith. She wasn't a filmmaker herself. She'd actually been a very energetic tourism development officer for many years. But Adbourne had run a classical music festival, which had been becoming less and less popular in recent years. Joanne was looking around for something to replace it and to use funds allocated to it to promote something which local people can enjoy.
Great. So tell us about the festival nowadays.
Well, it's held in the last 2 weeks of August every year, and short films from all over the world are shown in 3 places, in the theatre and our 2 cinemas. Several films are shown in 1 performance, and the whole thing lasts about 90 minutes. Tickets are very reasonably priced. Under 12s used to get in for 50p, but now we charge just £1, which is still very good value. £1.50 for students and £2.50 for everyone else. Performances are advertised all round town and also on our website, www.adbournefest.com. If you're interested in attending any performance, you can buy tickets online, of course. And you can also get them in the library, which is right next to the main shopping area. I'm afraid this year, tickets are no longer available from either of the 2 cinemas because of restricted opening times.
I understand you also run a film competition?
Yes, for under 18s. We have a different theme every year. Last year, for example, the theme was Future Planet, and the winner was a 10-minute documentary encouraging youngsters to be more aware of environmental issues, focusing on getting school kids to cycle to school instead of going by car. This year, the theme is Sporting Nation, so there'll also be lots of ideas to choose from. Now, we're always on the lookout for new local talent, so if you live in the Adbourne area and are under 18, you should have a go. We have an excellent prize every year donated by local businesses, shops, hotels, etc. This year, you can win a high-spec movie camera worth over £800. Application forms are on the website, and the deadline for sending in your film to enter the competition is the last day of July. It's May now, so you'll have the whole of June to be working on it.
Now you have some time to look at questions 17 to 20. Now listen and answer questions 17 to 20.
And what are the judges looking for?
Well, although we choose very topical issues like the environment, we're not looking for propaganda, you know, trying to get people to do something. Instead, we're looking for a new angle, a fresh way of looking at a theme. And of course, because it's a short film festival, it's not really about a fully worked story with well-rounded characters. It's more about good photography, conveying things visually.
Mm. And who judges the films?
A panel of three people who know a lot about film. We've used the same judges for many years, and we're very happy with their expertise. One thing we probably will change next year, though, is we want to add another class and another prize for older filmmakers. We'll keep it at a maximum of 10 minutes, though. The length works well for our festival. We also want to use different venues for the film shows, such as community centres and at least one school. It might make performances more accessible to a wider audience. We did explore the possibility of having late-night showings, but that's unlikely to happen in the coming year. So, as I say, if anyone's interested in submitting a film for our competition, go onto our website and you'll be able to access everything.
That is the end of part two.
You now have half a minute to check your answers.
Now turns to part three.
Part three.
Maria is a student at university. She has handed the first draft of an essay to her tutor. The tutor has read it, and now they are discussing ways the essay can be improved. First, you have some time to look at questions 21 to 25. Listen carefully to the first part of the conversation and answer questions 21 to 25.
Well, Maria, I have to say I was quite impressed by your essay. It's a big improvement on the last one.
Really? I'm glad. I put a lot more work into this one. I really spent ages on it.
Mm. And it shows. You've addressed most of the problems I pointed out last time. In particular, the style and language are much more appropriate for an academic essay.
So that aspect is okay?
Absolutely. If you carry on like this, you shouldn't have any significant problems in that department.
That's a relief. I've been quite worried about that, although I've been reading a lot of other essays to try to get the right style.
Well, I'd say you've been successful. There are just one or two minor things you could look at. Your punctuation's quite basic. It's really just full stops and commas. And parentheses.
Brackets?
Yes, brackets if you prefer. In academic writing, these are best used only occasionally, if at all. You use them rather too often.
Okay, I see.
And I'm sorry to mention it, but your spelling.
I know. But I'm working on a foreign computer. The spell checker doesn't work for English.
Are you sure? Have you tried changing the setting to English?
No, I haven't.
Well, I should see if that's possible. I haven't marked you down this time, but, well, some of my colleagues are a bit old-fashioned about spelling. I'd try to get that sorted out if I were you.
Okay, I understand. I'll try to change the setting.
Before you